Welcome to Aristotle Walks, where ancient philosophy papers are read aloud. The telos of this YouTube portion of Aristotle Walks is to make philosophy accessible for those with vision impairments. Today, I will be reading Posterior Analytics 219, A Dialogue with Plato, by Peter Adamson, published 2010 by Oxford University Press. Let's get started. There is not much that is uncontroversial about the last chapter of Aristotle's Posterior Analytics, but there does seem to be widespread agreement that the chapter contains at least two allusions to Plato. First, one of the problems Aristotle raises looks to be closely related to the problem set out in the Meno of how learning is possible. Footnote 1, see, for example, Jonathan Barnes, Aristotle's Posterior Analytics, 2nd edition, Oxford, 1994, page 260 to 261, Fairjohn's The Origins of Aristotelian Science, New Haven, 1991, page 46, D.W. Hamlin's Aristotelian Epagoge, Phronesis, 21, 1976, page 167 to 80, at page 173. Second, the part of the chapter in which Aristotle describes our ability to reach universals on the basis of sense perception has a clear source in Plato. Phaedo 96b 4-8, the group translation modified, "Do we think with our blood, or air, or fire, or none of these? And does the brain provide our senses of hearing and sight and smell, from which come memory and opinion, and from memory and opinion, which has come to rest, arises understanding? Ek tu ton de gignoito meneme kai doxa, ek de menemes kai doxes labuses to eremen, kata gignestai epistemen." Posterior Analytics 219, 100a 3-8. "So out of sense perception comes to be memory, as we say, but from frequently coming to be memories of the same thing arises experience. For memories that are many in number are a single experience, and from experience, or from the entire universal that has come to rest, ere me santos in the soul, arises the principle of skill or of understanding, technis arche kai epistemes." Footnote 2. Translations are mine unless otherwise noted. The quote is not exact, and the differences between the two passages will occupy us below. But the parallel is strong enough that Barnes has gone so far as to say that the source of Beta 19 is to be found in Plato, citing this passage from the Phaedo. 3. Barnes, Aristotle's Posterior Analytics, and one above, page 259. In the final section of this paper, I will propose that there is at least one additional Platonic reference in Posterior Analytics 219, the invocation of nous as a state of knowing superior to episteme. If this is right, then the three sections of 219, the setting out of the problems, 99b 20 to 32, the explanation of how we come to know the principles, 99b 32 to 100b 5, and the identification of the state, which knows the principles, 100b 5 to 17, all contain allusions to Plato. This suggests a hypothesis. Aristotle thinks Plato's puzzle about how we learn is applicable to the case of learning principles, so he uses Platonic materials throughout his entire treatment of the question. This is not to say that Aristotle agrees with Plato concerning the process by which we get principles. It is rather to say that Plato is the dialectical opponent with whom Aristotle is engaged in 219. Aristotle confronts a Platonic difficulty and deploys Platonic ideas and terminology in his solution, even though the solution he offers is non-Platonic. Section 1. Setting out the problems. Aristotle begins 219 by saying that it has now become clear what syllogism and demonstration, pseudogismos and apodeixis, are, and how they come about. These questions have thereby been answered for demonstrative knowledge itself, since this is the same, 99b15-17. What remains is a question about non-demonstrative knowledge, regarding the principles, how they become known, and what is the state of knowing them. This will be clear shortly, once the problems have been first set out. Perideton archon posteginontai gnorimoi, kai tis he gnoritsousa hexis, en teuthin estai delon pro aporesasi proton. 99b17-19. Actually, Aristotle mentions two questions here: how principles become known, and what is the state of knowing them. As several commentators have noted, these two questions will be answered separately, which gives the positive part of the chapter its structure. Footnote 4, see Barnes, Aristotle's Posterior Analytics, and one above, page 260 and page 268. See also, for example, Engberg-Pedersen, More on Aristotelian Epagoge, Phronesis 24, 1979, page 301 to 317, page 314 specifically. L.A. Kosman's Understanding, Explanation, and Insight in Aristotle's Posterior Analytics in Exegesis and Argument, E. N. Lee edition, Assen, 1973, page 374-92, page 385 specifically, C.C.W. Taylor's Aristotle's Epistemology in Companions to Ancient Thought 1, Epistemology, Everson edition, Cambridge, 1990, page 116-42, specifically 127. It is vital to distinguish between the two questions because it helps dispel the notion that there are two rival accounts of how we come to know the principles. On the one hand, an empiricist doctrine that invokes epagoge, on the other, a rationalist doctrine that invokes nous. As emphasized especially by Barnes, nous is not a name for the process or faculty by which we derive principles. It is the name for the hexis that results at the end of that process, where the principles are being grasped. However, Aristotle says that he will first set out problems, which are evidently distinct from the two questions. Thus, we have an aporematic section, 99b20-32, which precedes the solutions to the two questions. It reads as follows: that it is impossible to understand through demonstration without knowing the first immediate principles has been said before. With regard to knowledge of the immediates, one might pose the problem whether it, the knowledge, is the same or not, and whether there is understanding of each or not. Footnote 5. Eu is deleted in Ross, Oxford 1968, but retained by Barnes. Ross, page 676, notes that EU is clearly superfluous and unsupported by Eustratius and Philoponus. Back to the passage. Or there is understanding of the one and something of a different sort of the other, and whether the states are not in us and come to be, or are in us without our being aware of them. If we do have them, this is strange. For it would mean that we have instances of knowing more exact than demonstration, but are unaware of them. But if we acquire them, not having had them before, how will we know and learn them without it being from pre-existing knowledge? For that is impossible, just as we said in the case of demonstration. It is then clear that it cannot be either that one has them already, or that they come to be after one is ignorant and has no state at all. This opening section is typically, even self-consciously, dialectical. Not only do we have the statement of problems aporiae, from which the solution to our questions is supposed to emerge, but two positions are set out and then rejected, so that Aristotle's solution may appear as a happy medium between them. Let us first look at the three problems Aristotle sets out. 1. Is knowledge, gnosis, of immediates the same as knowledge of what is demonstrated? B. Is their understanding episteme? Footnote 6. For this translation of episteme and an illuminating discussion of epistemic terminology in Aristotle C. Miles Berniet, Aristotle on Understanding Knowledge in Aristotle on Science, the Posterior Analytics, a book, Padua, 1981, page 97 to 139. In this paper, I will use the term knowledge without qualification only in the broad sense that corresponds to gnosis. In other words, I will use it inclusively of both episteme and nous. Back to the question, of both, or is there understanding for one and another sort of knowledge for the other? Tu men episteme tu de heteron tigenos. Question C. Do the states of knowing come to be after not being present, or are they present without our being aware? Problem B presupposes a negative answer to problem A. That is, there is indeed a difference between the gnosis of immediates, i.e. principles, footnote 7, for another use of emesos to refer to the archai C Posterior Analytics 1271b21, as noted by Barnes, Aristotle's Posterior Analytics N1 above, page 94, indemonstrable replaces immediate at 71b26-8. As Barnes says, to be immediate is to lack a middle term, where I suppose that by middle term he means a genuinely explanatory middle term. That is, if all A's are C's is immediate, then it stands in need of no explanation, whether or not we could find some B such that all A's are B's and all B's are C's. See also Posterior Analytics 110. I call principles in each kind those items of which it is not possible to prove that they are. Lego de arcas en hecastogene, tautas has hoti esti me en dechetai dexai, 76a31-2, Barnes translation. And the gnosis of what is mediated by demonstration. Given that they are different, problem B arises. Is the gnosis of principles episteme? Which, as we know, is the appropriate word for the gnosis of things demonstrated. Seen in this light, the problem at hand may seem to be merely terminological, so that it amounts only to asking whether we should call our knowledge of principles episteme or something else. But of course, the point is also a substantive one. Since, as we already made clear in the first sentence of the chapter, demonstrative understanding episteme apodeictike is understanding through a demonstrative syllogism, Aristotle's problem amounts to the question of whether we know the principles by means of a demonstrative syllogism. The problem is one that has been mentioned already at Posterior Analytics 1.3. Footnote 8, see also the closely related Posterior Analytics 122. That chapter criticizes two unsatisfactory views, both of which assume that all understanding results from demonstration. Some argue that there must be first principles, prota, to prevent an explanatory regress, but since principles are by their very nature undemonstrated, they cannot be understood. And if they are not understood, neither is anything based upon them. This group draws the skeptical conclusion that understanding is impossible. Others accept circular demonstration, and so are able to say that everything is genuinely understood and understood in the same way. Aristotle has already told us his own view, in opposition to these rival theories. Posterior Analytics 1.3, 72b18-25, Barnes translation. We assert that not all understanding is demonstrative. Rather, in the case of immediate items, understanding is non-demonstrative. And it is clear that this must be so. For if you must understand the items which are prior and from which the demonstration proceeds, and if things come to a stop at some point, histatai de pote, then these immediates must be indemonstrable. We argue in this way, and we also assert that there is not only understanding, but also some principle of understanding, ou monon epistemen alla kai arcane epistemes, by which we get to know the definitions.
he tous chorus gnorizomen.
On the one hand, this passage fits well with 2.19 because it denies that there are demonstrations of the first principles. This is presumably why Aristotle tacitly assumes a negative answer to problem A in 2.19. He has already given the answer explicitly in 1.3. On the other hand, in 1.3, Aristotle seems to accept that we could call our knowledge of the principles understanding. It would just not be demonstrative understanding. In 2.19, by contrast, he will go on to reserve the word episteme exclusively for the kind of knowledge that results from demonstration. I will later turn to the question of why he operates with a more restricted meaning of episteme in 2.19. Footnote 9. Another point of contrast between 1.3 and 2.19 is less important for us. Aristotle specifies in 1.3 that the principle of understanding involves knowing horoi, which Barnes translates as definitions. The question of how the principles of demonstration relate to definitions is a difficult one, and I will avoid committing myself to any particular view on it. If I am successful in showing that 2.19 is a response to Plato, and one holds that 2.19 deals with definitions, then obviously it will be an interesting question whether and how 2.19 relates to Platonic discussions of definition. For this, see Ferrajon, The Origins, and one above. In any case, the Apparimatic section of 2.19 seems hereafter to drop problems A and B, focusing instead on problem C. Perhaps this is because we already know the answer to problem A, while problem B is relevant to the second question of 2.19, namely, what is the state in which we know principles? So it will be picked up in the last section of the chapter. Problem C, by contrast, will push us towards considering the first question about how we know principles. Yet problem C is not unrelated to what has come before. At first glance, it is hard to see this, or even to see what problem C is asking about. Aristotle speaks simply of states, hexes. Does this mean, for instance, both the state of demonstrative understanding and the state in which we know the principles of demonstration? What follows seems to rule this out, and to show that Aristotle is only asking about the states in which we know principles, for he says that if we have the states already, it would mean that we have instances of knowing more exact than demonstration. Acribesteras econtas gnoses apodexeos, but are unaware of them, 99b27. So what problem C in fact does is to present two possible solutions to the regress issue already discussed in Posterior Analytics 1.3. As in 1.3, we are given two views, neither of which Aristotle accepts. But now the views seem to be closer to what Aristotle would accept because they presuppose that we can have a knowledge of principles rather than saying principles could not be known, like the skeptics of 1.3, or that principles are unnecessary, like the circular reasoners of 1.3. The dilemma, then, is whether the instances of knowing the principles are acquired from nothing or are already possessed. One way of reading this dilemma is that the first position is Aristotle's and the second Plato's. On this reading, it would be Aristotle who thinks that the principles are not in us and then come to be. He would then explain how they come to be in the following section on Epagoge. And it would be Plato who thinks that we have the principles all along, but without being aware, because we have forgotten them. But this reading is obviously wrong, at least on the first score, because Aristotle concludes the aporetic section by dismissing both of the positions envisioned by problem C. He rejects the acquisition from nothing theory, saying that the states come to be after one is ignorant and has no state at all. Me de mean ekusan hexin, 99b 31-32.
One might also translate, and one has no having at all, since the noun hexis, of course, comes from the verb echo. What Aristotle is saying is that before we come to know a principle fully, we must have it in a sense and not have it in a sense. To put it another way, what problem C presents is a false dichotomy. Now, we have seen Aristotle make a point like this before in Posterior Analytics 1.1. Aristotle's mention of the need for pre-existing knowledge in order to gain new knowledge and the phrase, just as we said in the case of demonstration, would seem to refer back to Posterior Analytics 1.1. There, he distinguished between knowing something absolutely, haplos, and knowing it universally. I know universally that every triangle has internal angles equal to two right angles, but I do not yet know it of this triangle absolutely, because I do not yet know this triangle exists. So before I know this triangle exists, in a sense I have knowledge of it, and in a sense I do not. But we should not assume that Aristotle's distinction between absolute and universal knowledge is supposed to deal with the problem about regresses in demonstration. When he refers back to 1.1, he is only saying that the two problems are analogous. The Greek is hosper. Footnote 10. As Gilfine's paper in the present volume points out, the issue in 1.1 is a rather narrow one. What happens when we learn something about a particular that we already knew universally? Because this is a special problem, there is no reason to think that the solution offered there would apply to all learning. A similar point is made by D. W. Hamlin, Aristotelian Epagoge, Phronesis 21, 1976, page 167 to 80, page 174 specifically. Hamlin indeed specifies that the acquisition of principles would not be covered by the response to Meno's paradox given in 1.1. In 2.19, the sense in which I both have and do not have a state of knowing the principles is rather that I have a power, dunamis, which makes it possible for me to know them. This is the solution that will be set forth in the first positive section, beginning at 99b32. It develops nicely out of this aporetic section, and especially problem C, because it is presented as a compromise between the two views envisioned in that aporia. We neither acquire the states from nothing, nor have them already. Rather, we are born with a power which is ultimately responsible for our knowledge of the principles. Footnote 11, notice that dunamis can be invoked both with regard to the 1.1 problem and the 2.19 problem, since in the 1.1 case, I potentially know that this triangle is equal to two right angles. To actualize my knowledge, I need only to know that it exists and is a triangle. What about the identification of the second rejected view, that we have the principles already, with Plato's recollection theory? This is more tempting than ascribing the acquisition from nothing theory to Aristotle, and as Barnes notes, could be encouraged by the fact that Plato speaks of knowledge being present in us before we recollect. Footnote 12, Barnes, Aristotle's Posterior Analytics, and one above, page 261, citing Phaedo 73a and Meno 85c. But it has its own difficulties. For one thing, Aristotle's response to the view would be disappointingly abrupt and dismissive if we assume it is Plato's. He just says, if we do have them, this is strange, atopon, because these are such exact states, and yet we would not be aware, lanthanein, of them. In fact, this doesn't even look like a serious attempt to criticize Plato. Surely the whole point of saying we have forgotten our knowledge is to show how we could have it without being aware of it? Perhaps one could extract a better objection to Plato from what Aristotle says here, but it might be better not to try. A closer look at the Phaedo shows that Plato himself already presents the recollection theory as a compromise between two extreme views, much like the extreme views envisioned here in Aristotle's problem C. The Phaedo is famous for rejecting the possibility that we acquire ideas like equality entirely from our sense perception of equal things. But the Phaedo also rejects the possibility that we were born with the knowledge, epistamenoi, and all of us know it throughout life, 76a 4 to 5. For a man who has knowledge, epistamenos, would be able to give an account of what he knows, B5 to 6 group translation. But in fact, we see that people are unable to give an account. Plato's position is very like Aristotle's. He rejects two views according to which knowledge is wholly acquired or wholly possessed, in favor of the claim that although in one sense we have knowledge from birth, in another sense we do not. If we did actually have it, we would know we had it, and we would be able to give an account. Footnote 13. The parallel between Aristotle and Plato is even stronger if, with Barnes, page 261, we think Aristotle means at 99b27 that other people could not be unaware of someone's knowing something. For instance, if an infant knew the principles, this could not escape the notice of those observing the infant. In that case, the awareness in question could be closely linked to the idea of giving an account. For with his point that the knowledgeable man can give an account, Socrates too emphasizes that knowledge can be discerned by others. Despite this, Barnes seems to assume throughout his commentary that the position criticized by Aristotle in 219 is simply Plato's. I myself am skeptical of Barnes's reading here and would point to a different kind of parallel between Plato and Aristotle on the assumption that it is the knower himself who is aware or not of his own knowledge. In that case, what Aristotle is assuming is that knowledge, or at least the kind of knowledge in question here, which is more exact even than demonstration, entails knowing or at least not being unaware that one knows. This is a constraint which Plato also frequently seems to endorse, for instance in the Charmides. It may be that Aristotle speaks of awareness and not of giving an account, simply because it is problematic to speak of giving an account in the case of first principles. See further N21 below. What the recollection theory claims is not that the learner actually has knowledge from birth, but that the learner had actual knowledge before birth, which now needs to be recovered through recollection. Now, Aristotle may not be alive to this subtlety in Plato's portrayal of recollection. Perhaps he does think that we always have knowledge but are unaware is a reasonable way of characterizing the recollection theory. Alternatively, perhaps Aristotle thinks that recollection is a response to the problem of how we know principles on a par with his own response, a way of showing how we can both have and not have such principles. For my purposes, either interpretation will do. The more important point is that Aristotle assimilates the meno problem to his own difficulty about the principles of demonstration, so that the recollection theory becomes an attempt to dissolve this difficulty. It seems clear that he does make this assimilation, even if we decide that Plato's recollection theory should not straightforwardly be identified with the option presented in problem C. There are several signs of this in the text. As noted above, the present in us language used in problem C is borrowed from Plato. As also noted above, the demand for pre-existent knowledge at 99b29 points us toward 1-1, which explicitly mentions the meno. Footnote 14. One might add that another explicit mention of the meno problem in prior analytics 221, 67a, 21-25 mentions epagoge. This provides a link between that passage and 219, though it is clear that the prior analytics passage has to do with the problem of posterior analytics 1-1, even including the same example of the triangle, not of the problem of getting principles. The mention of learning in this sentence is another gesture towards the meno problem. Finally, 219 will go on in the immediate sequel to discuss memory. As I will argue in the next section, this can be understood as a continuation of the engagement with Plato's recollection theory. Before moving on to that part of 219, we should dwell for a moment on the question of whether Aristotle is right to see his problem C as intimately related to Plato's problem in the Meno. In one sense, he seems justified. Both problems consist in a dilemma in which we cannot come to know something because we either know it already or do not know it at all. Compare agnousi kai medimean ekousin hexin a Posterior Analytics 99b31-2 to me oista to parapan at mino ADD6. It is only when we reflect on the context of Aristotle's problem that the parallel seems less persuasive. In 219, Aristotle is concerned not with the acquisition of any knowledge whatsoever, but with how we get to know first principles. In the Meno, by contrast, the problem seems to be a more general one, about the possibility of all learning. Admittedly, unless Aristotle can show how principles are knowable, all knowledge will for him be impossible. So this may be a distinction without a difference. And certainly, Aristotle would be on firm ground in seeing his worry about how we get principles as a special case of Plato's worry in the Meno about how we learn. Still, if Aristotle is here in dialogue with Plato, we might expect him to turn his attention to Platonic passages that deal more directly with the issue of principles, archai. That, I will argue, is exactly what happens later in 219 with the invocation of nous. Section 2. The first question answered, epagoge and memory. The next and longest part of 219 is devoted to answering the first question, how do the principles become known? As we have seen, the aporetic part of the chapter has moved us towards the outline of a solution. We must both have and not have knowledge of them, which means having a dunamis rather than having actual knowledge or having no relevant state at all. The dunamis in question is our capacity for sense perception. However, Aristotle immediately adds that this power will not be superior in exactness to these. Me toi auten de ekein he estai tuton timiotera kata akribeian. Becker 99b33-34, where the referent of these, tuton, would seem to be the hexes back at line 25. Footnote 15, or, what amounts to the same thing, the instances of knowing, more exact than demonstration, at line 27. I take it that the gnoses are identical with the hexes. Obviously, the mention of exactness at line 27 is picked up here at line 34. In other words, the power which is ultimately responsible for our knowledge of principles is less honorable than the knowledge of principles which arises from that power. In fact, much less honorable, as is shown by the next remark that this power is present in all animals. This remark, I think, is meant to be jarring. How could the faculty which gives us knowledge about principles, and thus the summit of all knowledge, be present in even the lowliest animals? Aristotle's comment about whether the power is honorable ensures that we do not overlook how surprising this is. One is tempted to say that Aristotle is here moving on to a wholesale rejection of Plato's epistemology, or even an inversion of it. For, as every undergraduate knows, Plato thought that sense perception cannot lead to knowledge, and that it is the immaterial soul that knows through its direct confrontation with the forms from before we were born. Aristotle, by contrast, is claiming that sense perception, shared even with the animals, can give us the knowledge of the one over, para, the many, as he goes on to say at line 100a7. Of course, for Aristotle, the one over the many is a universal rather than a form, but the phrase helps to make the polemic clear. However, Although it is right to say that the passage as a whole responds critically to Plato's epistemology, a glance at the Phaedo again shows that Aristotle is closer to Plato than one might think. Phaedo 74e9 to 75a8, group translation. Socrates says, "We must then possess knowledge of the equal before that time when we first saw the equal objects and realized, enenoesamen, that all these objects strive to be like the equal, but are deficient in this." Simmias says, "That is so." Socrates says, "Then surely we also agree that this conception of ours derives from seeing or touching or some other sense perception, and cannot come into our mind in any other way, for all these senses, I say, are the same." Αλλά μεν καί τότε χωμολογούμεν με άλλοθεν αυτό ενενοε κενάι με δε δυνατόν ειναι ενοέσαι, αλ ε εκ του ιδέιν ε χαψασθαι ε εκ τίνος άλλες τον αισθέσεων τάωτον δε πάντα τάωτα λέγω. What Plato says here is compatible with Aristotle's claim that it is the dunamis of sense perception that gives us knowledge. Indeed, Plato emphasizes that there is no other way, me alothen, to reach knowledge of the equal than by sense perception. The difference is, of course, what sense perception gives rise to. For Plato, the result of sense perception is recollection, whereas for Aristotle, it is memory. What is then the difference between recollection, anamnesis, and memory, mneme? To find out, we can turn to Aristotle's treatise on memory, which explicitly discusses the distinction at the beginning of its second chapter. In what I take to be a swipe at Plato's recollection theory, Aristotle begins by saying that recollection is neither the recovery nor the acquisition of memory, for when someone first learns or experiences something, he does not recover any memory, since none has preceded. 451a20-23, Surabji translation. Footnote 16. I take the point made at Surabji Aristotle on Memory, 2nd edition, Chicago 2004, page 89, that chapter 2 of On Memory does not have criticism of Plato as its main purpose. Rather, it seems to me that Aristotle's goal is to explain what recollection would be in the context of his own epistemology. But this very goal presupposes a rejection of Plato's epistemology, which is understood by his remark here that when we first learn things, we are not recovering them. To proton mathe. It has been argued that the first chapter of On Memory is more thoroughly a reaction to Plato. See Lang, On Memory, Aristotle's Corrections of Plato, Journal of the History of Philosophy, 1980, page 379-93. As is here implied, recollection is the recovery of some experience or knowledge after a period of absence, whereas memory can follow on immediately from an experience without any gap. 451a31-b5. Another important difference between memory and recollection is that, as was already argued in On Memory, Chapter 1, memory belongs essentially to fantasia and is thus present even in some lower animals. The only requirement is that the animal must be able to perceive the passage of time. 449b28-30. By contrast, recollection is a sort of reasoning, syllogismos tis, and is thus found only in humans, 453a7-10. In short, recollection cannot be the explanation of how we come to know. This is because the recollection of knowledge presupposes that we have already actually had the knowledge, the very same knowledge we are now coming to know, and then cease to have it actually. Aristotle, unlike Plato, thinks that the learner has never actually had knowledge. Memory, by contrast, can help to explain how we come to know, because it holds the sense perceptions in the soul. Posterior Analytics 219, 99b, 49 to 100a1. After all, the dunamis that Aristotle invokes at 99b 32 to 3 is not a dunamis for knowing principles. It is a power to perceive sensible particulars. So he owes us an account of how we can bridge the gap from the sort of sense perception shared even with animals and the exalted state which he will go on to call nous. Memory helps to bridge this gap, but it is not enough by itself. We must also add the capacity for experience, empeireia, which is possessed by a subgroup of those animals who possess memory. Footnote 17, the same hierarchy of animals, those capable of sensation, those additionally capable of memory, those additionally capable of experience, is set out in Metaphysics Alpha 1, 980a27 to 981a1, Ross translation modified. By nature, animals are born with the faculty of sensation, and from sensation, memory is produced in some of them, though not in others, and therefore the former are more intelligent, phronimotera, and apt at learning, mathetikotera, than those which cannot remember. The animals other than man live by appearances and memories and have but little of experience, empeireia stimeteche mikron. But the human race lives also by the art and reasonings, techne kai logismois, and from memory experience is produced in men, for many memories of the same thing produced finally the capacity for a single experience. Haigar polai mnemai tu autu pragmatus mias empeireias dunamin apotelusin. It's interesting to notice that here too Aristotle draws a connection between memory and learning, mathesis, and admits that even animals can learn. For the relation between Alpha 1 and Posterior Analytics 219, see Barnes, Aristotle's Posterior Analytics, page 262. David Charles's Aristotle on Meaning and Essence, Oxford 2000, page 150 and following. Michael Freda, Aristotle's Rationalism in Rationality in Greek Thought, Oxford 1996, page 158 to 173. And now, Aristotle makes the central claim of the chapter as a whole. Posterior Analytics 219, 100a, 6 to 8. And from experience, or from the entire universal that has come to rest in the soul, the one over the many, which is one and the same in all those many things, arises the principle of skill or of understanding. The end of the passage. Though it has been said that this sounds like pulling rabbits out of a hat, footnote 18, C.H. Kahn, The Role of Nous in the Cognition of First Principles in Posterior Analytics 219, in Aristotle on Science, the Posterior Analytics, Bertie edition, Padua, 1981, page 385 to 414. In fact, the passage has built up gradually to the point at which the principle of understanding arises. A whole sequence which delineates both a hierarchy of cognitive states and a hierarchy of the types of animals which have those states culminates in this reference to the archae. As intimated above, the reason Aristotle gives this detailed exposition is to explain how such an honorable result could emerge from such a humble capacity as sense perception. The nested capacities of memory and experience do the work that pre-existent knowledge is meant to do in Plato's recollection theory. That is, they explain how one can begin from sense perception and end up with knowledge. Footnote 19. Notice that in a sense, Plato's epistemology as set out in the Phaedo is as empiricist as Aristotle's. As we saw, Plato says at 75a that there is no way other than sense perception to reach conceptions like equal. Likewise, in Posterior Analytics 219, Aristotle is concerned only with the principles that emerge somehow from sense perception. If there are principles that do not have their basis in sense perception, perhaps principles of reasoning like the principle of non-contradiction would be an example. Aristotle is not interested in them here, but the same is true for Plato in our passage from the Phaedo. But how can we be so sure that Aristotle still has Plato in mind here? The most obvious reason is the one given at the beginning of this article. The sequence sense perception, memory, understanding, episteme is taken from the Phaedo, which ironically is also one of the two dialogues to set out the theory of recollection. But perhaps this is not so much ironic as a case of Aristotle's dialectical method. He says here to Plato, in effect, "Your idea about recollection is unnecessary because in the very dialogue where you discuss it, you have given an adequate substitute mechanism, sense perception which yields memory and thus eventually knowledge." He ignores the fact that the passage on memory in the Phaedo comes at the outset of Socrates' autobiography and is in the form of a question, a kind of proposed topic of research on the part of the young Socrates. There is even less reason than usual to pluck this passage out of context and treat it as a Platonic doctrine, or even as a doctrine Plato would find attractive. But I suspect this is not carelessness on Aristotle's part. Rather, he is deliberately exploiting a Platonic resource to answer a Platonic question, even though it was not so exploited by Plato himself. To this extent, the passage is an ad hominem polemic. But the polemic is a subtle one. Aristotle's procedure looks even more subtle when we make a closer comparison between Phaedo 96b and Posterior Analytics 100a3-8. Plato says that from sense experience comes not only memory, but also opinion, and that from both of these, when opinion comes to rest, there arises understanding. Aristotle retains the idea of coming to rest, but not its application to opinion. He says, "Ek de empeireas e ek pantos e remesantos tu katholu." Here the force of a is unclear. It may be epexegetic or may be a kind of correction in light of the fact that experience has to do with particulars rather than universals. Footnote 20. So David Charles in the book Aristotle on Meaning and Essence and 17 above, page 149-50, referring us to Metaphysics Alpha 1, 981a5-17, says, "Experience concerns particulars while skill concerns universals, and actions and productions are concerned with individuals." But for instance, Sarabji, in Aristotle on Memory and 16 above, reads the A as epexegetic. J.H. Lesher, the meaning of nous in the Posterior Analytics, Phronesis 18, 1973, page 44-68, specifically page 59, mentions both options but finds the corrective reading, or rather, to be perhaps preferable. Either way, Aristotle has made two modifications. First, he gives memory an exclusive and indispensable role, whereas Plato apparently puts it on a par with opinion. Second, he eliminates doxa from the account entirely and replaces it with experience, or the whole universal which arises out of experience. This may not be the only disappearing doxa in our passage. Aristotle has just spoken of a principle of skill or of understanding, technes arche kai epistemes, and he goes on to explain the difference. If it is coming to be that is in question, then skill, but if being, then understanding. Ean men peri genesin technes, ean de peri toon epistemes, 100a9. This contrast between genesis and on, or ousia, is familiar from Plato. To take two prominent passages, Republic 7, 533e-534a, uses the contrast in the second account of the divided line, and Timaeus 27d-28a distinguishes a domain of coming to be from a domain which always is. Both passages make that which comes to be the object of doxa. In the Republic, this is of course subdivided into eikasia and pistis, and both passages also make being the object of noesis, which in the Republic is subdivided into dianoia and episteme. I will return to this welter of terminology in the next section of the paper. For now, I want to point out only that Aristotle may well have in mind Plato's contrast between genesis and on. If so, he has made exactly the same modification as he did to Phaedo 96b by eliminating doxa as that which grasps coming to be. This time he replaces it with techne, a notion also mentioned as the result of experience in Metaphysics Alpha 1. Why would he twice remove talk of doxa in this way, only to bring it up in the last section of 219 at 100b7? There are, I speculate, two reasons. First, and rather unsurprisingly, he thinks that knowing about the domain of genesis is an important undertaking, and thus honors it with the term techne. Second, and more important for us here, he wants to avoid Plato's suggestion that opinion is a necessary step on the way towards knowledge of principles. It is not clear what Plato means by saying at Phaedo 96b that opinion must come to rest in order to give rise to understanding. A natural thought is that it is the same requirement alluded to at Meno 97e 98a, when Plato says that true opinion must be tied down by giving an ites logismos. If this is what Aristotle understood Plato to mean, we can see why he resists the suggestion in the present context. Giving an ites logismos sounds very like giving a demonstration, whereas what we are interested in here is undemonstrated principles. Again, one should bear in mind that Aristotle's concerns here in 219 are narrower than Plato's concerns in the Phaedo and Meno. He is trying to explain how we know principles, not how we know anything whatsoever. Of course, it is controversial what exactly is involved in the experience or the universal coming to rest, which is the key step in the process that will be called epagoge at 100b4. But it seems uncontroversial to say that whatever this process consists in, it cannot require giving anything like an explanation or account that transforms a true opinion into a principle. As Aristotle has already said in 1.3, if we needed to give an explanation, it would not be a principle. Footnote 21. This point should be borne in mind when trying to understand the sense of account, logos, at 100a2. For some animals, an account comes to be from the remaining of such things, and for some, not. This had better not mean anything like a demonstration or even a justification for the truth of some belief, even though logos is used with that very meaning later in the chapter 100b10. Rather, I would suggest that the logos is something along the lines of an empirical observation about the particulars I have observed, and it is achieved once one has not only memory, but also empiria. For Aristotle, then, we get a principle when the whole universal comes to rest in the soul. 100a 6-7. When this happens, the process of epagoge comes to a stop. Footnote 22, on the topic of epagoge, see for instance Engberg-Pedersen, more on Aristotelian epagoge, and 4 above, Hamlin, Aristotelian epagoge, and 1 above, Hintika, Aristotelian induction, a French journal title that I cannot pronounce but I can translate it to International Review of Philosophy, edition 34, 1980, page 422-40. This is expressed by the famous simile of the soldiers, who bring the retreat to an end by each making a stand, 100a 12. The verb histemi, make a stand or come to a stop, is then used in a more metaphorical sense throughout the rest of this section, at 100a 15 and twice at 100b 2. It also appeared previously in Posterior Analytics 1.3, For if you must understand the items which are prior and from which the demonstration proceeds, and if things come to a stop at some point, histatai de pote, then these immediates must be indemonstrable. 72b 20-22 Barnes translation. In both cases, what Aristotle means by making a stand is simply the fact that a principle is reached. But the two contexts are rather different. In 1.3, Aristotle means that a chain of demonstrative syllogisms come to a stop at the undemonstrated principle. Here in 2.19, by contrast, he means that our knowledge of a universal, or, as he describes at 100b 1-3, several related universals, emerges from our repeated encounters with particulars. Given the careful way that Aristotle has reworked the sequence from Phaedo 96b, it is all the more puzzling to notice that this famous simile of the soldiers who halt their retreat fails to capture Aristotle's disagreement with Plato. I have argued that their disagreement is epitomized by the contrast between memory and recollection. Whereas memory naturally emerges from sense perception, recollection consists in the recovery of knowledge or experience that has already been actually present, but subsequently become only potential. If we apply this to the case of the principles, then both Aristotle and Plato can say that the principles are present in one way, potentially, but not in another way, actually. The difference is that for Plato, the potential presence is explained by previous actual presence, which needs to be restored. Now consider the soldiers. Like in a battle, a retreat is stopped by one man standing, then another, until the initial formation is restored. 100a 12-13. Here, initial formation renders arche. This seems to be a play on words, and there is some uncertainty about how best to translate it, and even whether the text might need emendation. Footnote 22, Barnes, Aristotle's Posterior Analytics, and one above, page 265, complains that the pun would be frigid, and says, I cannot imagine what starting point the routed soldiers might come to. He thus suggests alkane, a position of strength, for archane. This is ingenious, but I don't think the emendation is required. If the pun is frigid, that would certainly not be without precedent in Aristotle. To my proposed translation, compare original arrangement suggested by Charles, Aristotle on Meaning and Essence, and 17 above, page 267, and 44. Another possibility is that arche means that rule in the sense of command or discipline has been reimposed on the troops, a meaning that is in fact given for arche in LSJ. See further Ross, Aristotle's Prior and Posterior Analytics, and 5 above, page 677. But whatever we make of arche, the simile seems to presuppose that the soldiers were previously in the correct formation or position, that this formation or position was lost as they broke into retreat, and that it needs to be restored. The simile is thus perfect, but what it perfectly represents in Plato's view, not Aristotle's. Footnote 24. This tension is also felt but dismissed as inadvertent by Hamlin, Aristotelian Epagoge, and 10 above, page 178. It is to be presumed that one factor in the image, the fact that the stable formation that comes into being is the same as the original one, is irrelevant to the situation being described. Otherwise, we should indeed be back with the Platonic solution to the problem of how learning is possible. This calls for some explanation. It might help to reflect on what Aristotle wants to get out of the simile. Part of the point is clearly that the process of restoring order to the soldiers is gradual. One soldier stands, then another. Presumably, the individual soldiers represent the individual sense perceptions, which are retained in memory and grouped into experience. I think he may also want us to see that the soldiers are the right sort of thing to take up the correct formation. That is, they are potentially arranged as they should be, even while they are retreating. This is supported by the remark that follows the simile of the soldiers. And the soul is such that it has the capacity to undergo this. He de psuche huparke toi aute usa hoia dunastai paskin tuto. 100a 13-14. So Aristotle does get some mileage out of the vivid image. But still, it seems a badly chosen example if he is trying to distinguish his view from Plato's. On the other hand, perhaps the example is for this very reason well chosen. That is, it is one that Plato would find congenial. When Aristotle introduces the simile, he says that it depicts how it can be that the states are neither in us determinately, nor do they come to be from some other states of superior knowing. Hexeon gnosticoteron. Footnote 25. The other states of superior knowing are ruled out because we are after principles, so we cannot use some other sort of pre-existing knowledge to get the knowledge we are after here, as we do in the triangle example from Posterior Analytics 1.1, where we have superior universal knowledge, which we then use to gain knowledge haplos of this particular triangle. But from sense perception, 100a 10-11, this all seems to be common ground he shares with Plato's Phaedo. Footnote 26. Here I assume that determinately, aphorismenai, means something like actually, and that Plato would therefore agree that the states are not in us determinately. Compare Barnes, Aristotle's Posterior Analytics, and one above, page 265, who paraphrases, are innately present in us in an actualized state. But once the simile is offered, Aristotle extracts from it only his own view, namely that the soul has a capacity to undergo a gradual transition to its knowledge of principles. We do not need to postulate a previous state of actual knowing, which would be analogous to the previous formation of the soldiers. Read this way, the simile is not clumsily chosen. Rather, the choice of simile and the explanatory gloss that follows it show Aristotle's awareness of the extent to which he both agrees and disagrees with Plato. He agrees, that is, that sense perception is indispensable in the activation of knowledge, but he disagrees about the way in which knowledge is present in us prior to that activation. Here the word dunamis is doing much of the work for Aristotle. The principles are present in us, en duname, because we have the relevant dunamis or dunames, sense perception, memory, experience. One might worry that Aristotle is equivocating here, sliding between dunamis as meaning potentiality and dunamis as meaning faculty. But his point, that the soul is such that it has the capacity, dunastai, to undergo this, shows that both ways of translating dunamis are relevant to this passage. It is because the soul has a faculty that yields knowledge of principles that it potentially knows principles. Like the soldiers, the soul is the right sort of thing to perform the task at hand. This is a more modest claim than the one made by Plato about knowledge in general. For him, we potentially know because we once actually knew, though we have forgotten. Footnote 27. It is tempting to put the difference in Aristotelian terminology by saying that for Aristotle, our initial state is one of first potentiality, whereas for Plato, it is more like second potentiality or first actuality. But this is not quite right, because for Aristotle, knowledge that is potential in the sense of second potentiality seems to be previously acquired knowledge that one can think about again at will. De Anima 3.4, 429b 4-9. This point is noticed in the ancient commentary tradition. In his In De Intellectu, Philoponus postulates a level of actuality higher than first potentiality, but lower than second potentiality, to account for our state prior to recollection, and compares this to the knowledge of a drunk man. See Richard Sarabji, The Philosophy of the Commentators, 200-600 AD, 3 volumes, London, 2005, Section 3. Section 3. The second question answered. Episteme and nous. I turn now to the final paragraph of the Posterior Analytics, where Aristotle answers the second question of 219. What is the state of knowing the principles? Here is his answer. Posterior Analytics 219, 100b5-12. If, of the states of thinking by which we hit on the truth, ton periten de anoian hexeon heis aletheumen, some are always true, but some are susceptible to falsehood, for instance, opinion, doxa, and reasoning, logismos, but understanding, episteme, and nous are always true, and no kind is more exact than understanding, apart from nous, and the principles of demonstration are known most of all, but all understanding comes along with an account, meta logu, then there will not be understanding of the principles, but if there is nothing that can be more true than understanding apart from nous, then there will be nous of the principles. Aristotle's strategy is to itemize the ways of grasping truth, and by a process of elimination, identify nous as the only way that could be appropriate for principles. Conducting a process of elimination presupposes an exhaustive list of ways to grasp truth, yet Aristotle makes no attempt to explain why this list is exhaustive, nor, crucially, what the various items on the list are supposed to mean. One gets the unsettling feeling that we are supposed to know what he means already, or even that the list is meant to be familiar to us, so that it stands in no need of explanation. For some of the terms in question, this is true enough. Episteme clearly means demonstrative understanding in this context, and as the first sentence of 219 has announced, it has already been explained what this is and how it comes about. But what about the rest of the list? One place to look would be Aristotle's earlier distinction of doxa from episteme and nous, Posterior Analytics 133, 88b32-89a3, Barnes Translation Modified. There are some items which are true, and are the case, tina alethe men kai onta, but which can also be otherwise. It is plain that understanding cannot be concerned with these items, for then what can be otherwise could not be otherwise. Nor is nous concerned with them. By nous, I mean a principle of understanding. Lego gar nun arcen epistemes, nor non-demonstrative understanding, episteme anapodektos, which is belief in an immediate proposition, hupolepsis tes amesu protaseos. Now it is nous and understanding and opinion, nous kai episteme kai doxa, and what is called after them, which are true. Hence, it remains that opinion is concerned with what is true or false, but can also be otherwise. This makes it pretty clear what doxa means, and in fact does so by a very similar process of elimination. But unfortunately, all we learn about nous in this earlier passage is that it is the principle of understanding, which confirms what we are told in 219 but does not add to it. Even worse, there are two difficulties in matching this passage from 133 with 219. It leaves out logismos and uses non-demonstrative understanding apparently as a synonym for nous. Footnote 28, as Barnes, Aristotle's Posterior Analytics and one above, page 199, points out, the nor ude in nor in demonstrable understanding means i.e. not. This expression does not feature in 219, and in fact seems to be excluded by the terminology of the final chapter, where all episteme is the result of demonstration. This is a terminological mismatch we have seen before. Recall that Posterior Analytics 1.3 also spoke of non-demonstrative understanding. I have already raised but not answered the question of why 219 operates with the narrower meaning of the term episteme. For illumination on all of this, we should perhaps look outside of Posterior Analytics. There is a passage in the Nicomachean Ethics which is extremely similar to the conclusion of Posterior Analytics 2.19 and presumably refers back to it. Nicomachean Ethics 6.6, 1140b31-41a8. If understanding is a belief, hupolepsis, regarding universals and things that are by necessity, but there are principles of all things demonstrated and all understanding, since understanding comes along with an account, meta logu, then there will be neither understanding, nor skill, techne, nor practical wisdom, phronesis, of the principle of understanding. For what is understood is demonstrated, and the others apply to things that can be otherwise. Nor will there be wisdom, sophia, of these, for it belongs to the wise person to have demonstration of things. Thus, if those things by which we hit on the truth, aletheomen, and are never in error, medepote diapseudometha, regarding both things that cannot be otherwise and things that can, are understanding, practical wisdom, and nous, and it cannot be any of the three, I mean practical wisdom, understanding, or wisdom, then it remains lepetai, that there is nous of the principles. Footnote 29, for discussion of the terminology of the passage, see Taylor, Aristotle's Epistemology, and for above. This passage does use the narrow 2.19 sense of episteme, according to which understanding must arise from an account. Both passages use the phrase meta logu. Another commonality with 2.19 is that both passages use susceptibility to falsehood as a way of dividing up the cognitive terrain. Furthermore, the strategy of both passages is the same, in that both use a process of elimination to establish nous as that which knows principles. Again, a list of cognitive states is simply taken for granted here. The waters of Ethics 6.6 are somewhat muddied by the presence of practical wisdom and the extremely broad term sophia. But despite this, we can match up the three Aristotelian lists reasonably well. In each case, we have a division of the ways truth is grasped, with a primary distinction between what is susceptible to falsehood, or concerns what can be otherwise, and what is not susceptible to falsehood, or concerns what is necessary. Posterior Analytics 2.19 and Ethics 6.6 add a contrast between what is demonstrated and what is not, reserving the term nous for our knowledge of undemonstrated principles. Though Ethics 6.6 helpfully confirms and expands on the Posterior Analytics 2.19 list, it does not really help us with our original worry that this purportedly exhaustive list is itself presented as a fait accompli. Where do these lists come from? And in particular, why does Aristotle in two cases reserve the term nous for our knowledge of principles rather than following the practice of 1.3 and 1.33 in allowing for a kind of indemonstrable episteme? If we knew the answers to these questions, it might shed some light on what Aristotle means by the term nous in this context. Given the interpretation of 2.19 I have offered so far, you will not be surprised when I claim that the relevant background is Platonic. But my claim is a relatively modest one. I want only to suggest that the terminology of these lists, and in particular the contrast between episteme and nous, can be traced back to Plato. Where in Plato, then, do we find a list of ways of grasping truth like the ones just surveyed in Aristotle? An obvious place is the middle books of the Republic. The fundamental distinction drawn by Aristotle between what is susceptible to falsehood and what is not is of course reminiscent of the Platonic contrast between doxa and episteme at the end of Republic 5. One might also think of the distinction in Republic 7 between genesis and on, which I mentioned above in connection with 2.19, 100a9, because this is aligned with the same contrast between doxa and episteme. But these points of comparison are rather broad. There are any number of Platonic passages that contrast knowledge to opinion, and it seems futile to look for a specific passage that might lie behind this aspect of Posterior Analytics 133 and 219. A more promising precedent for Aristotle's lists is the divided line of the Republic. Here, Plato gives us a list of cognitive states. The word hexis is used at 511d, reminiscent of Aristotle's various lists. Unfortunately, matters are complicated by the fact that Plato runs through the segments of the line twice, with different terminology in the two cases. The terminology used for the domain of genesis is the same in books 6 and 7, Eikasia and Pistis. Republic 7 adds, however, that these two together can be referred to as doxa, 534a1-2. More variable is the terminology for the two segments in the higher part of the divided line, which, according to Book 7, concerns the domain of ousia. In Republic 6, they are identified as dianoia and noesis. In Republic 7, they become dianoia and episteme, with noesis becoming the term for the two together. But since Plato tells us himself not to be overly concerned by the terms used, Republic 7, 533d7-e2, let us look more closely at what is actually designated by these terms. The highest part of the line is said to represent the knowledge achieved by the so-called method of hypothesis at Republic 6, 510b-511d. Plato has Socrates contrast arts, like geometry, which simply stipulate their assumptions and determine what follows from these assumptions to the art of dialectic. This art treats the assumptions of other arts as images and uses these as hypotheses, ascending until a first principle, arche, is reached. This unhypothetical principle is then used as a basis for going back down through the hypotheses and showing them to be true. Plato's method of hypothesis is scarcely easier to understand than epagoge in Aristotle, and as with epagoge, I will endeavor to remain neutral on the details. I would, however, point out that some of the things Plato says about principles and dialectic chime with Posterior Analytics 219. For instance, he speaks of the greater clarity, saphenia, associated with the higher parts of the divided line, 509d9, and with the art of dialectic, which reaches the first principles, 511c4 and 511e3. This is echoed by Aristotle's emphasis on the exactness, akribeia, of nous, 100b8, compare with 99b27. Noesis, in Plato, partakes most of all in truth, Republic 511e3, compare with 510a9, and nous in Aristotle is likewise more true than other forms of cognition, Posterior Analytics 219, 100b11. All this should be set against the general observation that every item in Aristotle's 219 list, except logismos, footnote 30, I wonder whether logismos is pressed into service as a substitute for dianoia, the second highest part of the line in Republic 6, because Aristotle has already used dianoia as a general term for thinking at 100b6, something the Republic also seems to do in the close neighborhood of the divided line. The Shorey translation of Plato's Republic, Cambridge, Massachusetts, 1935, Volume 2, page 155, has a typically self-assured footnote instructing us that at 511a and 511c, dianoia is general and not technical. Another thing to consider about logismos is whether the phrase kai logismos at 100b7 is epexegetic, in which case it is merely an explanatory synonym for doxa. Here, it is relevant to mention again that logismos does not appear in the Posterior Analytics 133 list. In that case, logismos would, for Aristotle, presumably be aligned with eikasia and or pistis rather than dianoia. is also used in the passages describing the divided line. Most importantly, and most obviously, both Plato and Aristotle use the word nous for the knowledge of principles. A fly in the ointment is that neither version of the divided line contrasts nous to episteme, as does Aristotle in 2:19. Indeed, the only time episteme appears in one of Plato's lists is as a name for the highest segment of the line, when the second list uses it to replace noesis. But here we need to be careful. As we just saw, the highest segment of the divided line represents not just the knowledge of principles, but the whole process of ascending to principles and then using them to ground our knowledge. Comparing this to Aristotle, we might say that the highest part of the line includes both what Aristotle calls noesis, the knowledge of principles, and what Aristotle calls episteme, understanding through demonstrations based on principles. In this light, it is rather suggestive that Plato uses both terms for the highest part of the line. But to convince ourselves that the contrast of nous to episteme in 2:19 has Platonic overtones, we would need a passage where Plato says that noesis and episteme are distinct, with the former superior to the latter. Even more persuasive would be a passage where Aristotle himself ascribes this very contrast to Plato. And in fact, there is such a passage. De Anima 1:2, 404b 21-27. Again, Plato speaks in another way. Nous is the monad, understanding is the dyad, because it proceeds uniformly from the one, monachos gar epen. Opinion is the number of the plane, sense perception is the number of the solid. For the numbers are said to be the forms themselves, or the principles, archai, and come from the elements. Things are judged either by nous, or understanding, or opinion, or sense perception. Krinetai de ta pragmata tamen no, ta de episteme, ta de doxe, ta de aisthese. And these very numbers are the forms of the things. This is far from easy to understand, and raises notorious questions about how Aristotle's report of Plato's doctrine here and elsewhere relates to the Platonic dialogues. But it does establish that Aristotle is willing to ascribe to Plato the claim that nous is distinct from episteme, which somehow derives from it. Footnote 31. One could put the point more strongly if, as suggested in the previous note, logismos is synonymous with doxa in 2:19, and if we ignore aisthesis in the Platonic list at De Anima 1:2 because it is not a state of thinking. This would give us precisely the same list in Posterior Analytics 2:19 and the report of Plato, doxa episteme nous. My hypothesis, then, is that the engagement with Plato, discerned in both the aporetic section of 2:19 and in the section on epagoge, has continued into this final section. Aristotle's choice of the term nous is not surprising once we notice that Plato has already made noesis or nous the highest way of grasping truth and the state in which we know principles. Especially illuminating is the fact that, according to Plato, or at least Aristotle's version of Plato in De Anima 1:2, nous is prior to and the source of episteme. This leads Aristotle here, and in a later passage which refers back to this one, EN 6:6, to restrict the use of episteme by applying it only to demonstrated knowledge. Rather than saying that undemonstrated knowledge is another kind of episteme as he had in Posterior Analytics 1:3 and 1:33. Footnote 32. In 1:33, as we saw, he uses both terms nous and episteme for undemonstrated knowledge. This makes it especially likely that the reason for the distinction between the two terms in 2:19 is local to that chapter. According to my account, the reason is that 2:19 is a more careful engagement with Plato than 1:33. Just as we previously imagined Aristotle speaking to the Plato of the Phaedo, we can now imagine Aristotle saying something like this to the Plato of the Republic. If you ask me what name we should give to the knowledge of principles, a state of thought superior to demonstrated knowledge, then I am happy to use the name you used, nous.
Footnote 33. This is not to say that the Republic is necessarily the only text Aristotle would have in mind. As we saw above, the Timaeus also speaks of noesis in contrast to doxa, and one might think of nous in the Philebus as well. Matters are further complicated by the fact that the De Anima passage is not clearly based on any Platonic dialogue.
Of course, this terminological agreement with Plato does not imply philosophical agreement. In fact, it might be read as yet another dig at Plato, because Aristotle uses nous for a state which results from a process that begins in sense perception. As we saw, the indispensability of sense perception was common ground with the Plato of the Phaedo. The Republic, by contrast, says that even the practitioners of hypothetical arts like geometry proceed by means of thought, dianoia, and not sense perception. 5.11c3-4. While those who are doing dialectic make no use of sense perception whatsoever. 5.11c1. And there may be further disagreements lurking here. To explore them fully would require a detailed discussion of the epistemology of the Republic and how it compares to the epistemology of the Posterior Analytics. But to give one example, Republic 6 can be interpreted as envisioning one single unhypothetical principle which would underlie all knowledge, the form of the good. Some of Plato's remarks about the form of the good resonate with what Aristotle says about the principles of demonstration. For instance, the good is called the cause of understanding and truth, aitean epistemis kai aletheias, 508e3-4, to which one might compare Aristotle's phrase, the principle of understanding, Posterior Analytics 1372b24, 133-88b36, and 219-100b15. But there is no reason to think that in 219 Aristotle envisions that there is only one single principle for all understanding. It seems, rather, that he is talking about any of the various principles used in the various branches of science. So even if I am right to see Posterior Analytics 219 as a dialectical confrontation with Plato, this does not mean that Aristotle sees himself as taking over Platonic doctrine in any sense. Rather, he sees enough common ground between himself and Plato to make it worth engaging with his illustrious teacher, but his purpose in doing this is to emphasize the differences. For this reason, nothing I have said has any revolutionary significance for our understanding of Aristotle's epistemology. I have been focused on the Platonic background against which Aristotle develops his novel theory of epagoge, which yields nous. I claim that this background explains many of the puzzling features of 219, but I have not said much about the details of Aristotle's theory itself. Still, my reading, if accepted, would have implications regarding the relation of 219 to other texts. For example, my interpretation of the aporetic section has been bearing on Aristotle's attitude towards the theory of recollection. I suggested that Aristotle here takes over Plato's problem as his own, and that his solution is formally quite similar to that of Plato, since both attempt to find a middle ground between complete possession and complete absence of knowledge. This fits well with what I would see as a similar deployment of the Meno problem in Prior Analytics 2.21 and Posterior Analytics 1.1. Another example, I suggested that the word nous is chosen in Posterior Analytics 2.19 chiefly for its Platonic resonance. This should make us cautious in assuming a connection between the nous of the Posterior Analytics and, for that matter, EN 6, and nous in De Anima 3. For if the term nous is mostly or even partly chosen because Aristotle is dialectically engaged with Plato, This makes it less likely that he means us to understand 219 in the light of a theory of nous he himself develops elsewhere. Footnote 34. Hence, I am skeptical about an interpretation like that offered, for instance, in Kahn, the paper The Role of Nous, and 18 above. There is another, broader moral of the story I have told, according to which the whole of 219 must be read in light of a Platonic background. This should encourage us to think that Aristotle may be in dialogue with Plato elsewhere, even in passages where Plato's name is not mentioned. Peter Adamson is professor of philosophy at the Munich School of Ancient Philosophy, part of the University of Munich, which is known in Germany as Ludwig-Maximilians-Universität München. He specializes in late antique and Arabic philosophy. He acquired his bachelor's from Williams College and PhD from Notre Dame. From 2000 to 2012, Peter worked at King's College London, and since 2012 he has held a joint professorship appointment with Musaf at the University of Munich, keeping his affiliation with King's College. Peter also has a dope podcast called History of Philosophy Without Any Gaps that has been running since 2010. I highly, highly recommend it if you are looking to dip your toes in the ideas of many various thinkers throughout history. Though you're here listening to a very specialized paper, so perhaps not, I don't know. Most of the podcasts I've listened to is about 20 minutes, thus it doesn't go very deep into each thinker, but on the other hand, it has great breadth, and I and many others think Peter does a great job with these. I could keep going, but given that I'm currently attending courses he teaches, I will stop singing his praises here. If you made it this far, thank you so much for listening. I hope that this recording has been and is helpful to you. The goal, the end, the telos of Aristotle Walks is to make philosophy, in particular ancient, but also contemporary, more accessible. For the ancient philosophy portion of this channel, I am thinking primarily about students and scholars who have vision impairments, hence every footnote. If you have a vision impairment and have suggestions on ways to improve this resource, please contact me at my email, aristotlewalks@gmail.com. If you merely prefer to learn by ear, I hope this channel may benefit you too. The YouTube channel Aristotle Walks is a counterpart and antistrophos to my original Instagram account, Aristotle Walks, where I post excerpts of Aristotle's works. I would appreciate it if you followed it and/or subscribe to this channel. Thank you, and I hope you have a lovely day.